please welcome to the stage Kansas State University.
Good afternoon. My name is Philip Hodges, and on behalf of all of us here at Centennial Brewing Company, we're beyond excited to announce our newest product, the Wild Acres Lager. Now, this is no ordinary beer. This is a new craft beer on a mission to do good for people, producers, and the planet. This is a beer designed to put more purpose in your happy hour. The Wild Acres Lager is the world's first organic beer made from Kernza. Now, what is Kernza, you may ask? Well, developed by scientists at the Land Institute in Salina, Kansas, Kernza is a new grain crop that is the perennial cousin of the traditional annual wheat that we all know and love. Now, this means it grows back every year on its own after it's first planted. It uses far less chemical inputs and less water than annual crops, and it's long fibrous roots sequester carbon deep into the soil. You can actually see here a side-by-side comparison of the long perennial roots of a Kernza plant compared to that of a traditional annual wheat plant. Now, consumers are increasingly demanding products that support the environment and support organic agriculture, and this is exactly the demand that our product seeks to satisfy. On the producer side of this equation, our product allows farmers to continue to tap into the already lucrative market for organic Kernza. You can see here the average revenue per acre for producers growing organic Kernza is around $3,500 an acre compared to that of just under $500 per acre of organic wheat. Feedback from local Kansas growers and growers across the Midwest continue to validate the benefits of growing organic Kernza on the producer level. And a couple things to highlight here is the increased profitability per acre that producers are seeing growing organic Kernza, as well as a decreased need for inputs across their operation and a lower overall production cost compared to other crops. Now, at Centennial Brewing Company, we aren't just making beer. We are brewing change, as we are proud to introduce the world's first organic beer made with Kernza. Now, to understand more about our target market for this product, I'd like to hand the floor over to Reagan.
Thank you, Philip. Meet Chris Kraft. At 38 years old, he is a successful software developer in the Denver area. He makes $100,000 per year, and on the weekends, he enjoys frequenting food halls where he likes to test craft beer. A food hall is a trendy social venue where individuals can go to try new food and drink. But Chris is not the only one who enjoys craft beer. In Denver, Fort Collins, Colorado Springs, and Boulder, Colorado, there are approximately 50,900 males, much like Chris, who make up our target market. They fall in that 35 to 44-year-old age range and make $72,000 or more in annual income. In the first year, Centennial Brewing Company will capture 2.2% of the market share with Wild Acres beer. Going into the second year, we will increase the Colorado market share to 2.5%. Geographically, we will expand into Portland, Oregon, and Seattle, Washington, where there are approximately 55,800 individuals in our target market. There, we will capture 2.2% market share. In the third year, we will increase the Colorado market share to 3%. And in Portland and Seattle, we will be seeking a 2.5% market share. And then for geographic expansion, we will go into San Francisco and San Diego, California, where there are approximately 84,200 individuals in our target market. And there, we will capture an initial 2.2% market share. Now I'll pass it to Curtis for a competitive analysis.
Thank you, Reagan. Wild Acres is a one-of-a-kind craft beer brewed with Kernza. First, let's look at our strengths. Our lager is the only 100% organic Kernza craft beer on the market. As a company, we believe in sustainability, which is why our beer is sustainably sourced from start to finish. Wild Acres also offers a nutty flavor, diversifying the craft beer palate, blowing our customers away from the very first sip. On the flip side, we face some challenges. The higher cost of our ingredients pays off in terms of producer value, flavor, and environmental sustainability. As a smaller brewing company, we are able to be customer-driven, focusing on what matters most to our craft beer drinkers. Lager beer, a growing segment in the craft beer industry, also takes longer to brew, but you can't rush perfection. Our brewmasters take time and effort to carefully craft Wild Acres into the supreme beer that it is. When looking into the future, we also have many opportunities. With Wild Acres being the first product in an expandable line, we can further expand into IPA, Pale Ale, and wit craft beers. Lager beer was on a rise pre-COVID and is again gaining ground, showing a steady increase in demand among craft beer drinkers. With many major craft beers being also sold in retail stores, we also have the opportunity to expand into retail purchasing. On the other hand, every product faces threats. Kernza is fairly new to the U.S., and there are only 1,500 acres of organic Kernza being produced. However, to put this into perspective, we will only require 31 acres of organic Kernza in our first year to reach our target sales. There are also many craft beers on the market, making it a competitive industry to enter. Large brewing companies like Anheuser-Busch also try to imitate craft beers, making it even more competitive. But what these large brewing companies lack is the ability to tell a story and be customer-focused. Lastly, as a brewing company, we acknowledge all craft beers in the market, but it is simply too broad to look at them all. Also, we acknowledge all competitors in the food halls as our competition. In order to better look at our competitors, we specifically looked at those beers brewed with Kernza. In Boulder, Colorado, Upslope Brewing offers new Kernza Kolsch. In Minneapolis, Minnesota, 56 Brewing offers Kernza Harvest, a honey amber lager. Also in Minneapolis, Fair State Brewing Cooperative offers Keep the North Cold. Wild Acres sets itself apart from these competitors by being the only 100% organic Kernza craft beer on the market today. And now Ashley will present the business proposition.
Thank you, Curtis. Wild Acres depends on four key planning assumptions. First, that consumers will want to continue to drink craft beer. Second, that producers will want to grow Kernza. Growers will want to do this due to the producer value. Kernza has a greatly higher revenue per acre than traditional wheat. Third is that consumers will be willing to pay extra for environmentally sustainable products, as well as producers willing to use environmentally sustainable practices. Sustainability has become an important part of our everyday lives, and many people believe that it will help us and the earth in the long run, making it important to both the producer and the consumer. Lastly, Centennial Brewing Company hopes to have good relationships with the food halls in order to keep Wild Acres available. Next, we have our strategy statement. Wild Acres, made from organic Kernza, is designed for craft beer consumers looking for a new and distinct flavor. Our beer is nutty, earthy, and has an unmatched depth of flavor. Kernza is produced using farming practices that are environmentally friendly, sustainable, organic, and profitable for Kernza growers. Finally, we have three objectives for our first year. First, that we hope to have a net sales revenue of a little more than $1.4 million by the end of year one. Second, we hope to have an end-of-year profit of a little more than $283,000. And lastly, we hope to contain a customer satisfaction of at least 93%. These numbers are based off our forecasted financials and our target market. Next, Colin will present the action plan.
Thank you, Ashley. First up in the action plan is price. Wild Acres, we sold for a wholesale premium price of $2.48 per 16-ounce pour, or $307.52 per keg for retailers. With this price justification, this will allow Centennial Brewing Co., along with our target retailers, to have significant margin for profitability. And we are a premium price product due to the increased input cost of the Kernza grain. And this higher price comes from Kernza's current limited growing range, its environmental benefits, as well as our desire to increase margins for our producers. And with this evaluation, we suggest that our retailers should sell a 16-ounce pour of Wild Acres for $8. This pricing will allow us to compete directly against incumbent brews in the market. Next on the action plan is the product. As you've heard, Wild Acres is an organic craft lager made with Kernza. It's not only flavorful and delicious, but environmentally beneficial as well. These environmental benefits come from the Kernza grain's near 10-foot root system, which allow it to help sequester carbon, preserve water, and improve soil health, all which benefits the environment long term. All of this is what makes Kernza and Wild Acres the first of its kind organic Kernza beer. And next is the place. Wild Acres will be milled, the Kernza grain, will be milled in Salina, Kansas. Salina was chosen due to its close proximity to the current growing range of Kernza in central Kansas. And once milled, it will be shipped to Strasburg, Colorado for the final brewing process. Strasburg was chosen due to its close proximity to our initial target market in Colorado. This placement allows us to increase our involvement in Colorado, as well as decrease our final transportation cost. Once brewed, the beer will be kegged and shipped to retailers in our target market. Now I'll hand it over to Cameron to talk about our promotions.
Thanks, Colin. In year one, we'll hire one sales representative to cover our Colorado target market area. We'll also hire one full-time marketing personnel to cover all things digital and traditional marketing. Following our growth plan, in years two and three, we'll hire one new sales representative per city we enter into. By the end of year three, we will end with five sales representatives. In order to gain brand awareness, Centennial Brewing Company will participate in many craft brewing festivals across the state of Colorado. The most important being our Boulder Craft Beer Festival, where we will provide samples and environmental insight into the benefits of Wild Acres Lager, which our target market identifies as a key buying criteria. We'll also partner with the local food halls in order to gain traction at their events with our target market. We understand the importance of developing a website. Our website will contain videos and information about the brewing process, as well as information about our story, how our farmers cooperative was created. We'll also provide salesperson contact information and our mission and value statement, and most importantly, where the beer is sold. And finally, we understand the importance of social media in marketing efforts today. And although our target market of males aged 35 to 44 didn't grow up with social media, they are fully engaged in it today. We'll be using Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter to better reach our target market. Now I'll pass it back to Colin to finish up the promotions.
Thank you, Cameron. Another essential part of our promotion plans will be in the food halls themselves, where Wild Acres will actually be sold. As you can see on the screen, we'll create a custom and eye-catching tap handle for our Kernza beer, along with providing these food halls with beer mugs and glasses with our logo. And finally, giving back to the community is essential to us at Centennial Brewing Co. Since 2020, Colorado has been devastated by wildfires, with three of the largest fires in state history all happening in the last 2 years. California and Oregon have also been ravaged by these fires. To help protect nature and protect those living near it, 25 cents of every Wild Acres beer sold will be donated to local Red Cross sites in our target markets to help combat these wildfires. Now I'll send it over to Eric to talk about our financials.
Thank you, Colin. As we all know, money can't buy happiness, but it can buy beer. And I bet you're wondering how financially secure Wild Acres beer really is. In year one, we're expecting to sell 585,000 units in our Denver and surrounding areas. This will leave us at a 2.2% market share, and we should have a net sales of about $1.4 million. I would also like to recognize that we are accomplishing all this by utilizing just 31 acres of Kernza grain and costing ourselves just $107,000. After $1.1 million of expense, we are looking to see a $283 in profit at a 19.5% profit margin in year one. In year two, we're going to continue to expand in our Denver area, by 0.3% while also moving into our new market area in the Pacific Northwest. This should bump us up to about 1.2 million units sold with a net sales of $3.1 million. This year, we'll spend about $2 million in expenses and we'll profit around $983,000 at a 31% profit margin. And finally, in year three, we will continue to expand in our established markets while also moving into the California market, allowing us to sell 2,400,000 units and having a net sales of $5.9 million. The expenses this year should equal around $3.7 million and will leave us with $2.1 million in profit at a 36% profit margin. We firmly believe in the financial security of Wild Acres Beer, as after year three, we continue to see projected gains in both units sold and profit margin. And now I'll hand it over to Ben with monitoring and measurement.
Thank you, Eric. Our idea has all the ingredients for success in the current craft brewery scene, but we know that we need to be effective in our marketing and our communication in order to ensure success in the next few years. One of the best ways to measure this is return on marketing investment. Return on marketing investment is calculated by taking sales and subtracting marketing expense and then dividing that by marketing expense. Within the first year, we expect our ROMI to be 100%. Majority of our marketing expenses in the first year will go into establishing our brand as the premier environmentally friendly, sustainable craft brew in the Denver metropolitan area. And in the second year, we'll increase our ROMI to 150%, despite moving into new markets such as Portland and Seattle, and yet we will still have marketing expenses in establishing our brand further into the Denver marketplace. And then next, in the third year, we'll have a 203% ROMI, and we're confident we can reach this number even when we are moving into new markets in San Diego and San Francisco, and we will still be positioning our beer in front of the consumers in Portland, Seattle, and Denver as well. And in the this is how we calculate the ROMI for year one. 1.4 million in net sales and subtracting the marketing expense and dividing the marketing expense again to end out with that 100% ROMI you saw earlier. And next, we'll have our three key metrics that we will watch very closely in order to ensure success for our company in the next few years. One of the most important, of course, is sales. 1.4 million net sales is our projection for the first year, which we will monitor monthly. And if it's projected to be lower, then we'll have to increase our promotions. But if it's greater, we'll have to increase our production in order to meet the increasing demand in our Strasburg facility. Next, we have the profitability, which in year one, we expect $283,000, which we will monitor quarterly. But if it's less than planned for some reason, we'll have to review our costs in order to ensure that our process is as efficient as possible. Next, we have the customer satisfaction, arguably the most important. We have 93% customer satisfaction as our projection or higher, and we'll be monitoring this continuously. And for some reason, if it's lower than expected, we'll have to find the cause of dissatisfaction and fix the issue as quick as we can. The way we will do this is through our tabletop QR codes, which will be anywhere our beer is sold in the food halls. The way the QR code works is the consumer simply takes their camera and puts their takes the camera and puts it towards the QR code, and it'll link them to a customer survey with these three questions right here. And we will also have a small bit about our story as a craft brewing company. If the customers complete the survey, they will get 10% off of their next beer or any other potential discounts or giveaways we will do. So, for summary, we will increase our ROMI from 100% to 203% in the first 3 years, and we will also constantly watch our customer satisfaction in order to ensure our net profits and our sales are increasing from year to year. Thank you, and now I will have Philip to conclude.
Thank you, Ben. We are confident that implementation of this marketing plan will be a huge success for our company. We thank you all for listening and welcome any and all questions you may have for us this afternoon. Thank you.
I'm going to jump in on this one. Since you're only going to food halls, you've told us how many men there are in this age group and how much they love beer. How many food halls?
I'll take this one. In our target market in Denver, there are approximately 10.
So you're going to move 4,700 kegs your first year through 10 food halls.
Correct. There's a high volume of our target market is frequenting these food halls.
Are you still going to stay with food halls as you expand your market into the West Coast?
That's our plan initially. I think we will continue to reassess that as we scale.
Okay. I'm going to kind of stay on that subject a little bit. This has to do with your pricing as you go. I think it was $2.48 or so per 16 ounce is the retail, or I'm sorry, is the wholesale price on that. Looks like you're holding that price steady for the first 3 years for the wholesale price, yet you're doubling your year-over-year sales through each one of those, and you've got a pretty high retail margin for that retailer. Why keep the price the same over that three-year period when your sales are way up, your margin's already very high for that retailer, and he's seeing increased sales?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. So I think that based on the research we've done, we found that $2.48 per beer, they're coming in kegs, but is a really consistent price for other beers that are sold like this. This is going to be the best cost that we can sell it at wholesale for the next 3 years, because that's what the wholesalers are willing, the food halls are willing to buy it at. Now, of course, we can adjust as needed, but I think for the first 3 years in the foreseeable future, this seems like the best plan going forward at a price that both they will buy and that will make us profitable.
Is the anticipation on the pricing front, is the anticipation, though, that you would discount at least a little off the $8 retail price, at least in year one, as you roll out just to gain, you know, kind of attention from consumers, et cetera?
Yeah, so that actually is just a suggested retail price for the food halls, so we won't technically be setting it.
Okay.
We just set that $2.48 per beer price that's in the keg that's going to be sold to those food halls.
So I have a question for whoever had the action plan and the target audience. You can start thinking about who that was. Tom, what else do we know about the target audience, you know, in terms of where do they consume their media? What are they doing? What's the role of influencers within that? Because that didn't really show up in your action plan. So what else do we know about the target audience that we should be looking at in terms of building out something more than just a website? How do we actually find that influencer strategy for these people? What do we know about them?
Yeah, we decided that social media would be a great way to reach out to these people. So the website, obviously every company needs a website now. We picked Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter as big ways to reach out to them, to put our message out there and then get some of that earned media with some of the attention we're getting that way. And we're also going to be doing some, you know, media at these craft beer festivals, as we mentioned, and then at the food halls themselves, just to get our name out there to these people who are already coming to the places that we're going and already enjoy the craft beer. So that's the best way we can get to our target market.
Did you consider an influencer strategy at all?
We did, but I think at this time our target market isn't necessarily as involved with the influencers, because our target market is males age 35 to 44. And I would, based on our research, we kind of found that the influencers are really more influencing that target market just of a younger age. So I think that for this product specifically, it's something that we could look into eventually, but right now with the target market that we're gonna be kind of hitting on first, the influencer strategy doesn't seem to be as effective.
Okay.
I wanted to ask about market share. You've got 2.2% market share is kind of your foundation for everything we've been talking about for the last 15 minutes. So how did you arrive at 2.2%, and what's the competitive set? I mean, what's your universe for that?
So we did research into what other craft beer breweries had as market share, and this is a competitive market share, slightly aggressive. Then there was a second half to your question.
But is that of craft beers or organic lagers, or what's your set?
Yeah, it's craft beer in general is how we reached that 2.2%.
I'd like, you talked about how your product is 100% sustainably sourced, and you've really leaned in that sustainability of the product. First question, how does that apply to your production and your transport? Does the sustainability continue through how it's produced? Are you using biofuels and things to transport it? Like, how does that look?
Absolutely. So starting on the producer level, Kernza as a perennial grain already uses a significantly less amount of inputs. So from a chemical, at least an input perspective, there's far less going out, you know, in the production.
Well, if it's organic, there shouldn't be chemical
going
out.
Correct, absolutely.
So far less, yes.
Yes, and typically it's overall a pretty low maintenance crop for that reason as well. In a transportation standpoint, our mill is located in Salina, Kansas, and our brewery is located in Strasburg, Colorado. We did that intentionally to decrease the transportation distance to reduce our overall emissions. And Strasburg is conveniently located to Denver as well. So,
a second question to that, as you look at the acres, love that you called out that you only take 31. I'm guessing the folks that are growing this aren't just sitting there waiting for you guys to come and buy their crop. So knowing the time that it takes for a farmer to go organic, do you guys have any sort of contingency plan in place if your market share takes off and you need more acreage than you do? How are you managing that to ensure that you get what you need for production?
Yeah, absolutely. So we believe that there's such a high producer value with this that when we're starting with the 31 acres, we're going to quickly see other producers wanting to join our farmers cooperative. So really, to answer your question, I think that the producers are going to want to join into our farmers cooperative to capitalize on that producer benefit.
I'm going to go back to kind of the sustainability side as well. I think one of your first kind of statements this afternoon was purpose and the purpose-driven marketing, everything. I think that that's certainly something that we're all gauging and very conscious of. And you say that the buyers will pay more for environmental sustainability, but it would seem to me that really the 21 to 35 group would be more purpose market conscious, and we're targeting the 35 to 44. What was the decision there? Kind of instead of taking that younger group that might be a little bit more, I think, more poised towards a true purpose-driven purchase, and you went to 35 to 44?
So there were several decisions that went into that. The 35 to 44-year-old age range is still concerned about sustainability, but they also are more likely to fall in that $72,000 or more annual income range, and given that this is a luxury product, they have a higher willingness to pay for this luxury product. So we're not hurt in the sustainability side because there is still that target market in the 35 and up age range as well.
It seems like you have a relatively complicated story. You know, we've got organic, is Kernza, what the heck is Kernza? All those things that you're trying to explain, and I haven't seen a lot of detail about how you'll tell that story outside of QR codes, and maybe if you're lucky, somebody at a food hall who's talking about it. So how are you going to really ensure that the story is told accurately and with a relevant approach?
Yeah, absolutely. We have quite a few different promotional methods. I mean, first starting off on our social media, we really find that our target market is engaged in our three channels, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. So we're going to have frequent promotions on there of our story, where the beer is sold, pictures of all sorts of things that relate to our product. I think a really big one is going to be our craft brewing festivals. We find that our target market frequently attends these events, and they enjoy coming to them. So they want to see the newest and latest, greatest products. So by coming to it, they can stop at our booth, and we'll have our team there to tell them about the great benefits of our product. We also will have those tabletop QR codes, and those are going to be a great way. They get to fill out the survey, and then they can immediately be taken to our website where they will see all the details about that. And they'll have information about the brewing process, the environmentally sustainable benefits. But if you combine that with our social media and our events that we're going to go to, as well as the promotion we'll do through those, I really think we hit a wide range of promotional ability to reach our target market, explain our story in a simple and compelling way, and then provide them with the benefits of our lager.
Okay, I'll ask another one. On your measurement, what about taste? Like, that didn't seem to fall down to, like, till the bottom end customer satisfaction. Like, if you just have a QR code there and you fill it out, you get a discount on your beer. There's a likelihood people are going to fill that out before they've tried it so they can get a cheaper beer. So where does taste come into this on performance? Ponder that.
An answer, trust me.